and presenter of our speaker. He is a man with many gifts and talents. He's an educator, founder of the Genius Discovery and the Intentional Conference of Thinking. Welcome, Dr. William Maxwell.
We have to appreciate Mrs. Moore's thoughtfulness. Black History Month is sort of somber because our history is filled with agony and pain and suffering. And we don't know what our future is going to be like, but she said, let's make the end of Black History Month a little joyful, if we can. So she held me to some six little stories that should be inspiring. Thank you. Let's begin.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. That saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
I want to tell you the story of that song. The story of that song begins 190,000 years ago in Africa, where Africans invented all of the bases of civilization. The first being singing, music. The second being language, then sandals, then the caftan, then ropes, then rafts, and so on. All of the basic bases of civilization were all invented in Africa long before history was written. And this song, the story of this song, illustrates African history better than most. 1700 and about 47. By that time, approximately 5 million Africans had been stolen from Africa, headed for the West, heading for this part of the world. They were packed on little tiny ships, shoulder to shoulder. No water, no toilet paper. And when you're on a sinking ship or a bobbling ship, you vomit. And nobody to clean up the vomit. That particular ship that brought this slave from West Africa toward America was captained by a man named John Newton, a white man from England. They ran into the world's worst storm in the middle of the Atlantic, and they knew this little ship would perish. It was called a tempest, not a hurricane in those days. And John Newton was up above watching the horizon, looking for hope in a stormy sea. And way down yonder, in the bottom of the ship, he heard a Senegalese song, a prayer, God save us. And that was the melody you just heard. John Newton went back to England and gave up slaving. That song touched something in his soul that purified the evil within. It takes evil to produce slavery. You've got to beat the hell out of them, or heaven, or soul. It takes evil to produce slaves. But John Newton knew he had done wrong, and he took that song and thanked God, the Holy God. Thank God. Amazing grace. Grace is something you do not deserve. He knew he did not deserve salvation, and so he thanked God. That ship arrived, and he wrote the song many years later and became a priest. What's the moral of this little story? I was going to ask the kids. There are many morals. One is, even though we were put in slavery for 400 years, we're still in slavery. You are a slave unless you know how to do your own work. You need no supervisor. To be in any office today, somebody tells you what to do, when to do it, how to do it, and when you can leave and when you must come. You still have slaves if you're working with somebody else. We've been slaves for 400 years. In a system in which for every $100 owned by whites, blacks own $5. We are 20 times poorer than whites. We are still victims of 400 years of slavery. But we have to know there is an amazing grace. That's the moral. The next inspiring event, number two, is the Declaration of Independence, voted for on July 4, 1776. Listen to the first words of the second paragraph. I want the pastor. Pastor, will you read the... Let's see, are they there? Yes, sir. Can you read those words? Is your vision good enough to... No. Well, I need another pastor to read them. Yes, ma'am. Come on, you with the red dress. Stand up and read these words, please.
We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal, that are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among those are life. Among these are life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness.
Thomas Jefferson penned those words. They were voted approved July 4, 1776. Did Jefferson believe these words? No. He had 200 slaves. How can you write these words with 200 people in bondage in your house? He was lying through his teeth. We hold these truths to be self-evident. All men are created equal. Black men, yellow men, red men, white men. He did not believe it. What is the solution of these words? Where did they come from? From the heart of Jefferson, Adams, Washington, Madison? Where did these words come from? I maintain, many historians maintain, these words came from God over the objection of 37 men who signed them. Sometimes God tells us what to do over our own objections. This is inspiring because it teaches us God still participates in history. We have to be assured of that. And there's no greater evidence than our own American creed, restated 1,000 times by Lincoln, for example. 47 years ago, our fathers brought forth upon this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty. What other nation has been conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal? Lincoln said it. Lincoln believed it. Lincoln freed 3 million slaves. And someone asked him, Mr. Lincoln, what's the greatest thing you've done in your presidency? And this is his answer. The Emancipation Proclamation, January 1, 1863. Another inspiring event. 1945. We had been told for 350 years, if you're black, you're intellectually inferior. You can't learn math. You can't learn how to fly. You'll endanger lives. But there were black pilots at Tuskegee in Alabama who challenged that nonsense. And when they were trained properly, 24 months, they flew off to Italy, to North Africa, then Italy, and they bombed Berlin. Moreover, they never lost a carrier of troops, a B-47. They never lost a plane. They protected from the Germans. Flight after flight of soldiers. And when they came back, they had to live in segregated Alabama or wherever. One of them came to Phoenix and established an insurance company and became Arizona's first millionaire and married the prettiest girl in my high school in Phoenix. His name is Ragsdale. You can look him up. He became very wealthy living in Paradise Valley because he was well-trained. He proved, he dismissed that notion that if you're black, you're dumb. But we were taught that. And the sad truth is that most of us still believe it. We are 1/20th as wealthy as our white neighbors, which means we have bought that idea because we are not overcoming the economic gap. Martin Luther King's speech, you've heard it 100 times. Let's listen just one more time, please. Just for a few moments, because we've all known the American creed, as in our Declaration of Independence, as in Lincoln's Gettysburg Address, but no one had ever made it visual before. And this is considered the greatest speech of the 20th century. Listen to this man tell us who we are as a nation, as a human race. Listen for 2 minutes, maybe three.
I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will they be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that one day, even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. A dream that one day down in Alabama, with its vicious racist, with its governor having his lips dripping with the words of interposition and nullification, one day right there in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today. One day every valley shall be exalted, and every hill and mountain shall be made low. The rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. This is our hope. This is the faith that I go back to the South with. With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. With this faith, we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. This will be the day. This will be the day when all of God's children will be able to sing with new meaning, "My country tears of thee. Sweet land of liberty of thee I sing. land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrims' pride. From every...
Martin Luther King inspired the world. Did he inspire the children in your school? Do they play his sermon or speech in school these days? There is a rule that when you are inspired, you prove it by action. The greatest sermon after Christ is probably that of the Calvinist preacher in Geneva, John Calvin. He was so powerful in his sermons in the cathedral at Geneva that people from all over Europe flocked to that church to hear him. And here is the essence of his message. If you are a Christian, your job is to improve the world. You cannot die until you have done something to improve the world. My mother was 88 in dementia. She would scream to me on the telephone, "Junior, come down here." She's 88. So I go down to South Phoenix. "Mama," I say, "do you think they allow angry people in heaven? Do you think they allow hating people in heaven? Do you think they allow angry people in heaven? Anger is destructive. It's not allowed in heaven. Hate is not allowed in heaven." So I said to my mother, "Mother," I didn't call her mother, I said, "Mama." "Mama." She was angry for many reasons. "Mama, do you think they allow angry people in heaven?" She refused to answer. A few months later, she's in a nursing home in California with my sister in Rialto, California. And my sister's husband is there, Louis Jackson. He goes into her room and he sees a ball of light come into my mother's room. And her face changed. Completely changed. And that ball of light went out the room and she died. We then knew that this particular woman had been prepared for heaven. She no longer was angry. Not a drop of hate remained in her veins. Please tell your neighbors and friends, children and grandchildren and grandfathers, they don't allow hate in heaven. Martin Luther King made a great prophecy for us. When we decide to prepare America for its destiny, instead of hating, we will love. We will remember the 11th commandment, Pastor. And now I give you a new commandment, that ye love one another. Can we love our neighbor if they're different? If they're rich, if they're poor, can we love them? Well, we'd better, because we don't get into heaven unless we obey the 11th commandment. Amen. Get ready. So my mission is tonight just simply to urge everybody here to think. If you are a true Christian or a true Muslim or a true Jew or a true Buddhist or a true Hindu, whatever your religion, even if you don't have a religion, your duty is still, let's improve the world, beginning with love. I have a little notice here, a little quiz for the kids. I've made about 40 copies. I'll leave them here for anyone who wants to see the proposal. A way to show love is to make sure our kids get a good education. Amen. So that when they get to be 15, they no longer have to beg anybody for anything. This is the end of Black History Month. But we got a lot of work to do. Thank you.